Hi everyone and welcome back to the US Emily channel on YouTube. My name is Dr. Aksiniya and this video is part of our internal medicine residency bootcamp series and how to answer the most common pages. Today's video is dedicated on how to answer a page regarding a patient with fever. I hope you enjoy it. Let's get started. Question to ask the nurse when they call you to tell you that a patient has fever is to actually ask how high is the fever. Let's be clear on one thing. Temperature less than 100.4 Fahrenheit is not fever and does not require further workup. This video only deals with clear-cut fever above 100.4 Fahrenheit. And you might hear people saying, yeah, I had low-grade fever of 99 point something Fahrenheit. It doesn't matter. Nurse or patient tells you they have fever less than 100.4 Fahrenheit, you do nothing because this is not fever. And normally we check the temperature with oral thermometers in inpatient settings in the hospitals, but remember that the rectal temperature can be 1 degree Fahrenheit higher than the oral measurement. So what to ask next? Well, the trivial questions. Is this oral or rectal measurement? Did they recheck the measurement at least twice? Ask about the environment, for example, the silly stuff like is the patient covered in too many blankets or do they have like a warm blanket on top of them or did the patient just drink hot liquids, hot tea, coffee, whatever right before the temperature was checked if it was like oral measurement. The general rule of thumb is whatever issue the patient has, fever, shortness of breath, chest pain, confusion, first you must always rule out life-threatening causes. As intern or resident, second or third year, you must be aware and know what can kill your patient fast and try to diagnose these conditions and treat them as fast as possible until it's too late. This is your main goal as resident, especially when you're on call. In your head as resident, everything is urgent unless proven otherwise. So if the patient has a real fever, which is again more than 100.4 Fahrenheit, the first things to ask right there on the phone when the nurse calls you is the patient having any of the following like hypotension, tachycardia, confusion, shortness of breath? And why are you asking these questions? It's because you want to rule out sepsis and septic shock, which can be life-threatening conditions if not promptly addressed. So if your patient has any or some of these clinical signs and symptoms, what you should do is run to the bedside of the patient immediately to evaluate him. If your patient is hemodynamically stable and only complains of fever and chills, what you can do next is, instead of immediately running to the bedside of the patient, you can take a moment to quickly check his chart. Don't spend 1 hour reviewing the chart, just 5 to 10 minutes to get the main idea why this patient is in the hospital. So what you're looking for in the chart is the following. Of course, the main diagnosis, obviously super important to tailor your workup. Then you have to check if this fever is old or new. New fever always needs workup. Old, known, chronic fever spikes already on antibiotics might or might not require any further workup. You have to look for any available cultures, like blood or urine cultures. They might help you decide whether the patient needs more cultures to be drawn or not. If cultures, for example, were drawn earlier the same day or yesterday or even 2 days ago and the patient is already on treatment, you might not need to order more sets of cultures. If the source of fever is known already, there is no need for further workup. Or if the patient already has blood cultures pending and you see that the UA came back positive but there is no urine culture, obviously you will have to order urine culture only. There are so many different scenarios. Then you have to check whether the patient is receiving antibiotics or not. And more importantly, what type of antibiotics is he getting? And if these antibiotics that he's getting cover all the organisms that can cause fever. For example, are these antibiotics covering the gram-negatives or the anaerobes? And of course, you can refer to our antibiotics videos for more details on antibiotic choices and coverage and mechanism of action. Alright, so let's imagine that your patient has brand new fever that requires fever workup. As you all know, the fever is most commonly the body response to infection process. going on somewhere in the body, so the body temperature increases in attempts to stop the replication of the offending agent. Now your job is to find the source of infection and treat the patient. Once you're at the bedside, after you have reviewed the chart, for example, you can physically look for the source of infection before ordering any labs or imaging studies. Examine the skin for any decubital ulcers or any skin breaks that might have become infected. If patient has any existing wounds, make sure you take a look at them and check for any signs of infection there. Normally, if the patient has a cast on, we don't take the cast off, obviously, to examine the skin. You call orthopedics to come and help you with that if you have high suspicion that an infectious process might be going on under the cast. Also, check for infected IV lines or central lines. Ask the nurse how many days these catheters have been in already. If patient has indwelling Foley catheter, again ask when was it last changed. Also check the urine in the urine bag, if it looks dirty or not. If you find any source of infection on the patient's body, you typically need to take cultures from that source before starting the broad antibiotic coverage. There is controversy regarding culturing wounds, so please refer to your hospital policies. Let's say your patient does not have any identifiable sources of infection after your physical exam. Then you need to order some labs to look for infection. You need to order CBC, which is complete blood count with differential and a smear. Abnormal CBC or smear may provide clues to the underlying diagnosis. For example, if you see leukocytosis with more than 10,000 polymorphonuclear leukocytes, or bundemia with more than 500 non-segmented neutrophils, then you might be thinking there is a bacterial infection going on. If you see eosinophilia, then you're thinking parasitic versus fungal infection going on. You should also check the acute phase reactants, ESR or CRP. They lack specificity, but these markers are markers of inflammation and they decrease, if they're positive, they will decrease the likelihood of factitious fever. You also remember that elevated ESR and CRP can be used to monitor disease progression. So it's a good idea to draw them at the beginning of the febrile episode. Also, ESR but not CRP may be raised artificially in hypergammaglobulinemia and in some rheumatologic diseases like PMR. You should also check CMP. For example, hypernatremia may suggest dehydration. Elevated B1 and creatinine may also indicate renal impairment or dehydration again. Elevated hepatic aminotransferases, AST and ALT, may be a clue to a viral infection. You should also check the UA, and please remember the UA should be clean catch. And if the UA is positive for pyuria, then you must order urine culture. After you have ordered all these labs, the imaging studies that you might consider ordering is chest X-ray. Obviously, you're going to look for a new infiltrate indicating pneumonia. You can also look for lymphadenopathy that will suggest tuberculosis or lymphoma, for example. CT abdomen is not routinely ordered. If you have high suspicions for occult abscesses or hematomas, then it's a good idea to order CT abdomen. If you have any subtle central nervous system symptoms or signs, you should think about ordering some head or spine imaging and performing lumbar puncture as well. Last but not least, don't forget to make your patient comfortable by ordering some antipyretics like acetaminophen for symptomatic management. Also, don't forget that acetaminophen is contraindicated in acute liver failure. You will also have to cover the patient with broad spectrum antibiotics as per your hospital protocols. And also don't forget to give your patient IV fluids if they are indicated, if the patient looks dehydrated, which is very often seen in patients with fever. And something to think about, obviously not in the acute settings of you being on call, answering pages and acutely managing patients, is if fever always due to infections? And the answer is not at all. Not all fever is due to infections. There is this term called fever of unknown origin, and it is defined as fever higher than 38.3 Celsius on several occasions, lasting for at least 3 or 2 weeks without an established etiology despite intensive evaluation and diagnostic testings. The three general categories that can cause fever of unknown origin, as you can see on this slide, are infections, malignancies and rheumatic diseases. We already went over the initial workup for infectious causes, But the workup for the other causes include serum LDH, remember to check if you have suspicions for PCP pneumonia, for example. You can check for HIV antibody test and viral load. Of course, rheumatoid factor, heterophile antibody test for syphilis, creatinine phosphokinase, CPK, for conditions that can cause rhabdo, like seizures, or even mycoplasma pneumonia can cause elevated CPK. You can check antinuclear antibodies, also the TB skin test or the interferon gamma release assay. You should also check for serum protein electrophoresis, for multiple myeloma, CT scan of the abdomen and chest. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you found this video useful. Have a great day, everyone, and see you on the next video.